Do you bleed blue? If you do, this is the show for you. The BlueNote Fan Report, hosted by
the Hawaii Blues Fan. Aloha, Blues fans, and welcome to the BlueNote Fan Report. I'm Guy, the Hawaii Blues Fan, and normally I host alone, but today I'm bringing on Michael Dante from Pennsylvania. He's a big fan of the show, a big fan of the Hawaii Blues Fan, and he asked if he could come on and co-host. So, Mike, welcome to the BlueNote Fan Report.
Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. I love that jersey you got behind there. I think I told the story of how you got it signed at the Winter Classic, right?
Yes, that was a memory I'll never forget for sure.
Was that?
I'll never forget that.
Did you get it signed before the game or after the game?
It was actually before the game. Actually, the day before the game, walking alongside Busch Stadium, my girlfriend and I were going out to dinner, and someone flagged me down and said, "Nice jersey," and I looked behind me, and it was David Perron, and luckily my girlfriend was on the ball and had a Sharpie, otherwise I wouldn't have gotten the autograph.
So. Oh, man. You know, that's a cool story. I'm hoping we're going to talk about him a little bit later in the show, and you may not be happy with what I got to say, but we'll get there. But before we get there, Mike, you know what people need to do? They've got to subscribe to my channel.
Ring the bell.
That's right. They got to ring that bell because when they ring the bell, they get the notifications. And when you get the notifications and you watch the video, put your thumbs in the air like you just do, Kale. Help me get the likes up to a lot. Well, folks, today we're going to cover the West Coast Swing. Me and Mike are going to talk about those three games, and then we'll talk about the home game against the Coyotes. I've got a really good fan of the game. My fan of the game is going to his first Blues game against the Coyotes. That's cool. Got another nice tat, and I got a pet of the game. I got to say thank you to the Lounge, the We Bleed Blue fan group, and the St. Louis Blues Nation. I have put some posts in asking for tattoos and pets, and you guys are responding. I appreciate it. You're helping the show along. When I say this show is about the fan, I mean it's about the fan. Well, Mike, now we're going to talk about the West Coast Swing. A lot of people are happy about one game and upset about another game, but in my opinion, they're wrong. So let's talk about the first game. Blues go in after 3 days off to Anaheim and play the Ducks. Now, the Ducks were on a little bit of a hot streak. They had won their last two games, but they're still at the bottom of the barrel. Correct?
Yes, they're ever since, I think they started off pretty good, and then they just faltered to nothing, and they've been in the basement for a long time.
Yeah, and so this game, to me, if you remember, the Ducks were the game that started our 11-game winning streak just before the All-Star break.
That is correct. They did.
And this game to me seemed like it should have been one of them games that the Blues won 6-1, 7-2, 6-0. I mean, it should have been a blowout in my eyes.
Just like they did in that game that started the winning streak. I think it was a 5-1 score.
Yeah, I mean, it was a blowout, and that's what I thought it should have been. Now, this game didn't have that feel. Nobody played well, including Bennington, and this is where I get into trouble. A lot of people think Bennington played pretty decent. I don't. Right? Bennington did not play well. He gave up, like the one goal he gave up where he tried to do that thing with his, you know, he tries to bounce it off and catch it in his glove. Well, you know what? If you don't catch it, you'll leave a juicy rebound because our players don't know how to clear out the garbage.
Nope.
Right? There was a duck right there. Goal. Now, the strange thing that happened in this game is one of the very few times that pulling the goaltender early works. Now, you and me were talking about this, and you thought it was a late power play, and you thought they should have pulled the goalie earlier in the power play.
I thought they should have pulled the goalie right when the penalty was called, because it was an offensive zone face-off, and, you know, they were down a goal, and I thought they should have pulled the goalie because there was given the amount of time left in the game, but they did pull the goalie, and they got the goal they needed. And
well, hold on. Hold on a sec. You're jumping ahead here a little bit. They pulled the goalie, but they waited to pull the goalie. And I got to say, for the first time in a while, I agree with Booberry. I agree with what he did. And the reason I agree with it is I think a lot of times coaches pull the goalie too soon. You should not be pulling that goalie just on the initial rush. You shouldn't pull the goalie until you have absolute puck control. When you have that, because if you don't have puck control and you pull the goalie, you're giving up a goal. You've taken away the reason for pulling the goalie right away. If you get it down there and you have puck control and then you pull the goalie, you have somebody coming into the flow who's the defense isn't set up for. They're not ready for it. Then you have an open man with an open lane. And you know what? That's exactly what happened towards the end of that power play. That's when Berube pulled Binnington. And that's when, and I can't remember who scored the goal.
I think it was Robert Thomas.
Thomas. Thomas gets into a good position, fires a goal. I mean, it was a beautiful goal, right?
Two goals that game, Matt.
Tied the game up. Yeah, that was the second goal of the game. Ties the game up. But it showed, to me, it showed that when you pull the goalie at the right time, instead of just pulling the goalie to pull him, you allow yourself to control the play better. Right? Now,
yes,
shortly after that, O'Reilly decides that enough's enough. He gets the puck. He sneaks in, gets some speed through the neutral zone, gets into the offensive zone, and then he gets a pass to Petrangelo, bombs it in. Right?
Yep.
So two goals in, I think it was 22 seconds or 12 seconds. 12 seconds.
Yeah, right? There wasn't much time left at all.
We're going to show that play right here.
Here comes Petrangelo. Firing it right on. Rebound. Gets it another stop. Back-to-back beauties. Penalty done. Back on the ice, steal. It's Parayko. 6-on-5. Back to Parayko. Shooting. One more. Rebound scores. Robert Thomas has tied it.
Here's the shot by Parayko. Oh, it comes off the end boards. And Thomas is able to get to that puck. And he absolutely roofs it. The left leg of John Gibson was there. But Thomas goes up and under the bar, gets it over top of the pad, and that is an enormous goal for Robert Thomas and the St. Louis Blues. And not scored since January 10th. He double dips tonight, Dan. We're back to even, and here's Petrangelo scores! A smart shot by Alex Petrangelo. There were layers of people in front of him. The Ducks got back to the puck. Braden Chen gets to it. Did Chen touch it, or does it go off of Adam Henrique? Petrangelo did not want to get it blocked. It's the skate of Adam Henrique.
Wow.
And into the back of the net. And what a 12 seconds for the St. Louis Blues.
Okay, so now everyone's going, oh, this was a great win. This was a great win. Not to me. It was a stolen 2 points. I'll take them. But don't put more credit into the 2 points than it needs to be. Do you agree?
I agree. They were sloppy a lot of that game, when they got the 3-1 lead especially.
Yeah, they should have lost that game. They pulled it out. They pulled it out against a weak team. I'll take the 2 points. Now we move to L.A., and the Allen haters come out. Why is Allen starting this game? Because it's back-to-back, right? You know, Binnington can't, and Binnington did not. I'm sorry. Binnington did not play well against the Ducks, right? I originally thought that they should have switched it. I thought that Allen should have played against the Ducks, and Binnington should have played against the Kings, because he hadn't played a team that he beat that beat him before, right? If you remember, just before the All-Star break started,
yeah,
the Kings beat him and beat him pretty good.
Yeah, big.
Right?
They clobbered him.
So it would have been nice to see him come into this game and play the, you know, and show some rebound. They didn't do it that way. But, oh, my goodness, did Allen play out of his gourd?
He did, indeed. I'll give it to him.
Right?
Allen, that was a game and a half by him.
Made good saves. Covered the defensive breakdowns when there were a few, just laid into it. And then the neat thing about this game was in the third period during the Barbashev goal, John Hamm was up in the booth.
Yeah, awesome.
Yeah. I'm going to show that here real quick. This is John Hamm calling the Barbashev goal.
Challenging thing for me to get out of the ice, but I do love it. I love skating. I love this play right now, and I love that goal.
By Barbashev. How about it?
Ivan Barbashev, fourth line, contributing so hard. God, he's a spark plug.
What a call that is. Holy jumping.
Barbie reminds me, remember Ian LaPerriere?
Yes.
LaPerriere used to come over the boards, and he would just go nuts. Oh, God, I love it. I love it. And he loves it, too.
Look at that nice little backhand pass.
Look
and now Sammy Blay.
Saucer.
Just, isn't that nice?
Sammy Blay. Who is this guy?
He's a French-Canadian boy.
Kid. Oh, over the glove, what? Over the outstretched glove. Oh, so good.
Yeah, you like Barbashev, too. Huh? He's
I
really coming on.
I love Barbashev. Yeah, he's a spark plug. Like that whole fourth line, I just love it.
Believe it or not, I went, when I was in high school, I ran cross-country against John Hamm.
He was, that is cool.
He's like a year or two behind me. So I did one of my races was with the county schools, and I ran against John Hamm.
Well, that's something.
Yeah.
That's
well, really, we'll really never remember each other. We'll never even know we met each other. But hey, at least that's something in my backpack. So we get the 4-0 shutout. Everyone's happy. Everyone's great. And then comes the Shark game. Now I said before the Ducks game that we had 6 games coming up, and we needed 8 points out of those 6 games. Remember that?
Yes, I do.
So we got the 4 points out of the Ducks and the Kings, and I was real happy with that. If we lost to the Sharks, I wouldn't have been disappointed. They're a good team. We had beat them 4-0, but they turned around and beat us 4-0. So, you know, there's some play in there. But I'm looking forward to this game because I think that the Blues have a chance to really show that they can do what they're supposed to do and be that team that we want them to be. And this game kind of started out that way. Blues scored semi-early. I think they got one in the first 6-7 minutes, right?
Yes, Pat Maroon, the rebound there.
Right? Maroon gets it. Pareko fires it off, hits the end board. Maroon is Johnny on the spot, pops it in. However, towards the end of the second period. Now, here's the other thing. They started Allen. And I got to be honest, I don't have a problem with that. But the Allen haters, the Black Glasses Allen haters, were out right away. I mean,
they were in full force.
Full force. It's bad. And I think we'll talk about that after we talk about this game. I want to get into that with you a little bit. But the three types of Blues fan that we have are really making it difficult for us to be a solid fan base in my eyes. Let's get back to the game a little bit. So late in the second or the first period, or shortly after the Blues score, the Sharks score, you know, right away. Then they score the second goal late in the first period. It's 2-1 going into the second. I'm not disappointed. I'm not surprised. I'm kind of expecting it. I looked at both goals very closely. Neither one of them were on Allen directly. The first one, a lot of people say, it was a 5-hole goal. Okay, I get that. It was also a power play goal, and Mr. Bomeister was so far out of position, he allowed the Shark to get in to the circle.
And he's been playing really well down the stretch, too.
Right. That is one thing with our power play. They seem to shift, and I'm going to show that goal right here so you'll see what I'm talking about.
Here is Heed for Vlasic. Heat comes in, and a drive, and that hit Meyer, and never got on goal. Now Meyer in front of shot, he scores! Timo Meyer ties it, and he has scored goals in 4 straight games. His 25th of the year. Bomeister back defending, gets some help from his partner Pareko. There's Hurdle for Couture in front, they score! Meyer again, and it's 2-1. That's a great pass and a great goal by Meyer, and that shows you his hands.
So he gets the goal through the 5-hole, and I give it that Allen probably should have closed his 5-hole a little quicker. My problem is he should have never been that open for the shot, right? So That's why I don't put that goal on Allen as much. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that Jay Bouwmeester was really out of position there. That was way, I don't even, he was in left field somewhere.
Yeah, he should have been at the far post, and he was at the near post. You can't have a guy completely behind you that you don't see. I mean, if he's at the far post when, I forget his name, Monte or whatever it is, skates in front of him.
Skates, he fire.
When he skates to the circle, Bouwmeester sees it and can cover it. Well, because Bouwmeester's at the near post, he can't cover him. By the time he gets to the circle, by the time Bouwmeester sees it, all he does is create a lane.
Yep.
And that's what creates...
which in that case was a lane. Like I said, Bouwmeester's been playing very well down the stretch, so I kind of felt bad because now the Bouwmeester haters are like, oh, same old Bouwmeester back.
Well, actually... the Bouwmeester haters weren't out so much as the Allen haters were.
Right? Yeah, that's... not even close. Right. There's still Bouwmeester haters.
Then towards the end of the second period, the same thing happens again, but this time it happens 5-on-5. Right?
Yep.
Yeah. Defense breaks down a little bit. Guy gets in the dead center, right in the scoring zone. This is the one thing that people don't realize about most of Allen's goals. They're not from the outside. Now, when he gives up an outside goal, everyone goes, oh, my God, it was a softie he should have gotten. You're right. He gives up the odd one. But the majority of the goals that he gives up are the
prime scoring areas.
Right there, right? The prime scoring area right in front of the net where the defense is supposed to make sure that somebody isn't.
Yep.
Right, and that's the thing that I talk about with the so-called Allen haters, right? They only see that Allen gave up a goal. Well, late in the third, or middle of the third, O'Reilly, if I remember correctly, or no, not O'Reilly, Shen.
Yeah, Braden Shen. Yeah.
Shen takes it on his own on a power play, steals the puck. Buries it.
That was beautiful. That was a beautiful play.
Beautiful goal. 2-0. Or 2-2. Great, great start to the game. You know, great, you know, it's toward the end. We're going to steal a point. I'm happy. I'm happy with the point. I really am. We have, at this point, we have 5 out of 6 points on the West Coast. That's not bad.
You can't forget it was another one of those 3-game and 4-night stretches on the road. So.
Yeah, so at that point, you're not so upset, but Allen gives up the breakaway goal, you know, gives up the goal in overtime, and the Black Glasses Allen haters, oh my God, did they come out.
Yeah, they did.
Allen cost us the point! He should have stopped that goal. I don't know what his problem is. He couldn't make a save to save his rear end. He's so horrible. Why haven't they traded him yet? Why haven't they just put him in the minors? Why are they even playing Allen? I don't understand it. Dude, Allen saved that game. Right?
He most definitely did. Yeah.
And that's...
Most definitely. No ifs, ands, or buts.
Right? So we get 5 out of 6 points. And then yesterday we hear, or today... Today is Monday when we're filming this. We hear the news that Tarasenko is out for 10 days. Upper body injury.
What is 10 days?
You know, the thing about this injury, I mean, no one's saying what it is, and everyone's saying they're watching the game and they don't see him get hurt. Someone had told me, and I'm not going to say who, that it looked like his shoulder got hit sometime during the game. If it was shoulder, I don't think it would be a 10-day thing. I think it would be day-to-day.
Yeah.
I have a feeling this is a concussion. Right?
Just what we need.
Yeah. But here's the thing. You know what? I think this comes at the right time. Right? And we'll talk about it in a second. We'll talk about it in a second, but this comes at the right time. The other major injury that we have right now that is affecting us is your boy, Perron. There's something that I want to say, and this is speculation only, and this is my feeling, this is my commentary. David Perron has been cleared to play. Coach Berube said today, when he's ready to go, when he feels like he can play, we have a spot for him. Jeremy Rutherford put that out. He also came back and said, he put it out on Twitter, he also said that he didn't feel like the coach was calling Perron out. You know what? He was calling Perron out. Perron is saying that he has a vision issue, yet he has passed every concussion test. I think Perron is afraid to get hit, and I don't blame him. I honestly don't blame him, but you know what? With what you're getting paid to play, get your ass on the ice.
I agree, and especially because we brought him in to be a prime producer for us. He was a prime producer on the hottest streak in the league for points when he went down, and yeah, he needs to get on the ice.
Right.
He's good to play. As long as it's not headed for nothing, I don't know.
You know what?
We're not him either. So,
what I think needs to happen, and again, just my opinion, at practice tomorrow, someone needs to go up and whack him. I mean, just put a hit on him. Let him have a hit.
Get back in the zone, yeah.
Let him have a hit. Let him get hit. Good, solid hit. You don't need to take him out, but you need to hit him. He needs to feel a hit. He needs to go, ooh, wow, what happened? Oh, okay. Oh, I feel good. Oh, I can take a hit. And he'll get back on the ice. Now, if he does have an absolute vision problem, I get that. Get him to a doctor and let's see if that's what he does have.
Yeah.
But if it's, you know, to me, Berube called him out. And
yeah,
I got to admit, I'm okay with that.
And Berube's really, when he calls you out, he's not going to be direct. It's going to be one of those, I'm calling you out, but you're going to have to figure it out for yourself that I'm calling you out. He's not going to tell you directly.
You know, and I think I talked to you a little bit about this. I'm still not the happiest of people about how the Predators games went down. We had the two games against Nashville, if you remember, the home and home.
Yes.
And the Sunday game was on NBC. And during the first period, I even showed it on my show, the announcers start talking about how Coach Berube said, we had a locker room issue that had to get fixed. The guys didn't trust each other or whatever. And I'm thinking to myself, what the just happened? To me, that was the worst time for that to come out. Now, we've been told for years
that was
an issue.
Yeah.
Right? And, you know, it looks like it worked, but it was in the middle of a six. This is my problem with it. I don't mind a coach calling out a team in the middle of a 10-game losing streak. But when you're in the middle of a 6-game winning streak, and you have a quote-unquote fragile locker room, that's Berube's words, not mine. A fragile locker room, and you're going to say that? Wrong time. And you've seen it a little bit. I think it's reared its head a little bit in some of these injuries, in some of the play. We're slipping back. You know, we gave up another 2-goal lead.
Yes, the second game against Nashville, I believe, yes.
Right? No, we just gave up a 2-goal lead against the Ducks.
Yeah.
Right? We had a 2-goal lead against the Ducks and gave it up. So it's that style of play that just we need to figure out how to play better.
During the winning streak, they kept their foot buried on the gas. They were I don't think they trailed in a game in some ridiculous amount of time.
Like 590 minutes.
590 minutes they trail. And now it seems to be like, since they came back down after the winning streak ended, they seem to get leads again. It's been the same old Blues where they back on their heels but they get a lead, which isn't a good sign. You know?
Yep. Well, so we're playing Phoenix on Tuesday. We're filming on Monday. So when this gets released, Tuesday morning. I'm going to go right here and now, and you haven't heard this yet. I'm going to make a bold-ass prediction. Are you ready?
Let's hear it.
The Blues are going to win the division.
I hope you're right.
You know, but here's what I've got to say about this. The Blues have 14 games left.
Non-playoff teams, most of them.
All but three of them are playoff teams. The only playoff teams they have are Pittsburgh, Tampa Bay, and the Knights. They play Tampa Bay and the Knights, back-to-back with the day in between. By the time they play Tampa Bay will have the President's Trophy sewn up.
Yep.
Right?
Yes,
The next six games are this. The Coyotes, the Senators, the Penguins in Pittsburgh, back-to-back with Buffalo, who's reeling.
I'm going to that. Yeah.
We beat Buffalo very good back in December on the 27th.
Yep.
Then you have Edmonton and Detroit at home for a four-game, the start of a four-game homestand. That's one losable game there. You should win five of those six games.
Yes.
Right?
I agree.
That's 10 points. That right there puts you in the playoffs.
Yep.
Right? That's 89 points. 89 points basically puts you in the playoffs. If you pull a point out of Pittsburgh, 90 points.
Yep.
Now, right after that, you have Tampa Bay and the Knights. Tampa Bay, I think, is winnable if they have already clinched the President's Trophy.
The Blues already shut them out, actually, this year.
They beat them 1-0, but Tampa's going to want revenge, right? And it's in the middle. It's the third of a four-game homestand. Not bad. Then you play the Knights on Monday night. End of the month. Knights are pretty well solid in that third spot. I mean, I don't think that they can't slip into the Coyotes are so far from them that they can't slip into a wild card spot. But I don't think they can get second either. They might have a chance at second, but I'm not sure. At this point, they may relax a little bit in the last 2 weeks of the season. Then you have a quick road trip. You go up and play the Rangers and the Devils. Both of them are reeling.
Yeah.
You play Colorado at home.
We beat them all year.
All right. You go and play Chicago in Chicago. They may want to come at us. I mean, it is a rivalry game, but their season's done.
That's a problem game, I think. I think that game might pose a problem because, honestly, Chicago in the head-to-head games, I don't think the Blues, other than that one game that the Blues actually destroyed them, Chicago has pretty much owned us this year for some reason. I don't know why we've had trouble with them, but we have.
Well, we're almost even in that series. We had the two overtime losses. We had the one win, and then they had the one win. And we had the one win where we really just pounded them.
Demolished them.
Yeah, 7-2. And then we had the other one that they got us. I mean, we had the loss, the 1-0 loss.
Yeah.
To the Bomeister gift.
That's correct, yeah.
Right?
Yep.
So in that case, the only thing that I would be worried about is if I was Coach Berube, I might be sitting some of my stars may not be getting their normal minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I would see the third and fourth lines getting more time. Right? Just for the injury bug. Then we finish with Philadelphia.
In Vancouver.
And in Vancouver. Right? Now, that's our schedule.
There'll be two games I'm going to, actually. They're the last two games we're going out for those two.
Well, hey, man, when you're there, maybe we can do some video stuff and keep this going.
Yeah, that would be cool, yeah.
Right? And absolutely. Then, well, so now that I said that, let's look at you look at Winnipeg and the Jets, and they both got tough schedules. They've got half of their teams are playoff teams. And they even play each other.
Yep.
Right? This isn't a walk in the park for either team. And really, right now, you only got to win two or three games more than one of them.
And the Blues have games in hand, too, I think, of most everybody.
We have one game in hand currently. We have one game in hand on the Predators, and we owe a game to the Jets.
Okay.
So that's we're catching up. We're getting caught up. Now that all the byes are gone, we're pretty well caught up. So now that I said that, I think that they're going to win against Phoenix. And I'm going to go, I'll let you give your prediction first.
You want a score prediction or you just want
to... Yeah, what do you think is going to happen in the game and a score prediction?
I'm going to go 4-1 Blues, the Coyotes score first.
As long as we score first? Or Coyotes score first?
No, I'm going 4-1 Blues, but Arizona scores the first goal. It's going to be one of those games where Arizona scores the first one and the Blues get back on it and... We score four, and we get ones in an empty net. So 3-1 with empty net, 4-1 Blues.
Yeah. The one that scares me is Clayton Keller, right? He's from St. Louis. When he's played in St. Louis before, he's gotten a goal or two. He likes playing in St. Louis, you know. When I talked to Eileen Law, he was one of the guys that he mentioned, you know, wanting to be an All-Star next year to come to St. Louis for the All-Star game. I would love to see that happen. I think you're close, but I actually think it's going to be closer to a blowout. I think it's going to be 5-1, maybe 5-2. But I see Bennington starting this one, and I see Allen starting. Actually, I would start Bennington against this game and the Bennington against this game and the Ottawa Senators, and then I would start Jake against the Penguins. Right, give Bennington some of his confidence back because I think it's down a little bit, and Jake will have his confidence because he's facing the Penguins. They are a perennial Cup team.
I actually have a prediction that the world's probably going to hate me for, but I shared this with you in the past and recent days, actually, and I shared this even in the fan group, that I believe Jake Allen is going to take the starting role back, and he will be the starting goaltender when the playoffs start. Hands down, no ifs, ands, or buts.
Yeah, I think...
overrule it. Experience is going to overrule it.
Well, this is what I may do. In the first round, if you have home, I would start Bennington in game one. Right? If you're at home.
Talking like, that could like alternate the goaltenders, kind of, you're thinking?
Well, I think you start him at home, and if he has one of those really, really good home games, right? Okay, you're net for now. Earn it. Keep it. Don't make him think that it's just his net. You know, he's going to have it no matter what. Let him know that he's got to play out of his rear to keep that net. Because I don't mind Allen starting in the playoffs. Allen is a good playoff goalie. When the defense plays right, he is a good playoff goalie.
He is absolutely. He was sensational in a lot of playoff series for us. That he was,
Well, yeah, we beat the Wild in five games. He was absolutely perfect. And then we caught the Predators basically on a roll with a hot goalie. And even though we played well, they just were on a roll. We couldn't score, you know, we just couldn't score on them. And that's, you know, that when that happens, you just hope for the best.
Yep.
All right. So, Mike, I appreciate you coming on.
Thanks for having me.
It was an honor and a pleasure to talk to you. We will do this again. Mike, mahalo, aloha, and until we talk again, thank you for coming on the Blue Note Fan Report. Well, I want to thank Michael for coming on. Great, great time talking with him. I hope we get to do it again soon. Mike's a passionate Blues fan just like I am. Knows a lot, pays a lot of attention. He'll be a great addition to the show when we have him on. Now, a couple things that have happened since we did that conversation. Arizona got pounded by the Blackhawks. I can't say that I'm happy the Blackhawks won, but they pounded them yesterday. Today, when we see them, they're a wounded animal, so it is a little scary, but I think the Blues are going to do well. Bennington starting tonight, I found that out, and Thomas moved up to the top line. I know a lot of people in the groups wanted that. Got to say thank you. So let's move on to my favorite segment, about the fan, the part that's about you. Now, I had said earlier that my fan of the game was going to go to his first game tonight. Unfortunately, my fan of the game is feeling a little bit under the St. Louis weather. Chase and Blaine, I know you guys aren't feeling good, and I hope you still get to go to the game, but I promise you, as soon as you're well enough and you can get pictures in that, I will make you two fans of the game. This is my shout-out to you. Enjoy the game if you get to go. And boys, I promise you, you will be fans of the game. With that being said, what do I do for fan of the game? I lost my fan of the game. Well, my fan of the game this time is not actually a person. Well, it's a person, but it's a Twitter account. Civil War Schwartz. If you have not seen this Twitter account, I'm going to show up a couple of his posts. He is funny. He's interesting. He basically makes Schwartz the general of a Civil War army. And he posts about the Civil War army moving forward with Colonels Tereshchenko and Shin and Corporals Thomas and things like that. It's really, really funny. I've talked to him offline. He's a good guy. He's asked to remain anonymous because he said it adds to the mystique, and I agree. I will keep that anonymity, and sooner or later, he's going to decide to want to come on the show. Civil War Shorts, you keep doing what you do. Keep posting those funny tweets. And guys, if you go on there, go on and follow him. He's a good laugh. I've seen his post in a few of the different groups. They share him around. He said I can use them. They are good. Civil War Shorts, thank you for letting me make you fan of the game, bud. So I was running out of tattoos. I put a post in the We All Bleed Blue group, the St. Louis Lounge, and St. Louis Blues Nation, and boy, did you guys come forward with your tattoos. Everyone said I could use them. Everyone's been PMing me and letting me know, you know, where they were done and all of that, and one of them that came up was this beauty. This is on Danny Weiss. Danny got it done by Jason at Iron Age Tattoos, and I got to tell you, I really like this one. It's one of the simple ones with some intricacy to it. It's the old style trumpet with the St. Louis Blues around it, and it's breaking through his skin, and it's showing that he bleeds blue. This is well done. The design is great. The intricacy of the blood dripping down, of the skin tearing. Oh man, Danny, I like this one, bud. This is a good one. When I do my end of the season tattoo show, I would not be surprised if this one makes the top 10. Would not be surprised at all. Danny and Iron Age, I've had a bunch of your tattoos. So if somebody knows someone at Iron Age, you might want to show them this show and have them get in contact with me. Right? Maybe we could do something. But guys, great tattoo. Thanks for letting it be my tattoo of the game. Well, for Pet of the Game, I did the same thing, but I did it in St. Louis Blues Nation. I'm new to that group. Well, I'm not new to it, but I'm new to being the Hawaii Blues fan and doing my lives in that group. And I wanted to give them a chance to get involved with the show. And Joe York, who's had his tattoo on, says, hey, I got a Shibu Inu named Daisy. And here she is. Ego search complete. Well, I got a whole bunch of pets coming up. There's some beautiful ones in there. And Daisy is absolutely beautiful. Daisy just stands out. Pretty dog. I like her colors. I like her face. Joe, thanks for letting Daisy be the pet of the game. And St. Louis Blues Nation, thank you for stepping up and giving me a bunch of pets for the final push. Well, guys, the show's going great. Don't forget about the contest. We talked about it a little bit at the beginning. I have 4, maybe 5, I can't remember the exact number, of these original posters that I'm showing here. There's their original. They're not repops. They're from 1991. These things are gorgeous. John's dad saved them for him while he was in Panama. While he got stationed in Panama, his dad saved hockey cards and posters and all kinds of things. And John is graciously allowing me to give them away. John, I can't say thank you enough. Just remember, you got to put a hashtag, and starting with the Charlie Marlowe interview, any episode going forward, if you put a hashtag on the episode, you get 1 hashtag per episode, and I don't care what the hashtag is, 1 hashtag per episode, or if you go on Hawaii Blues Fan Clan and put a hashtag there, you're going to be entered. These posters are beautiful. I can't wait to send them out. I'm going to give them out on the 19th. On the 19th, I'll give them out. But you guys, right now I don't have enough hashtags to give out all 4 of them. Throw me your hashtags. Ari, what do you tell these beautiful people that watch the Hawaii Blues Fan Show? That's right, Ari. We tell them let's go Blues because Uncle Guy is bleeding blue with you. And I love doing the show. I love it. And I got a special guest coming on for Thursday. Special guest. You guys know him. A lot of you guys know him. I think it's going to be a great interview. I can't wait to have him on. Maybe you should make some guesses in the notes. Aloha, mahalo, and let's go Blue.